Hello, everybody. Welcome to our industry program of Doku Baku 2020, which is our fourth edition. Today, we are here for a masterclass with Marco Gastin. Hello, Marco.
Hello, Veronica.
Marco is a director and producer. He himself is coming from France, but has been living a very long time in Greece. And he is running a company called Minimal Films since 2002. And Marco, you have a long list of films that you have directed and produced. Many of them are dealing with the topic of Greekness and Frenchness, like Marseille, A Greek Profile, and I believe Demokracia, The Way of the Cross. This was nominated for Prix Europe in 2013. And we met last time together when you were producing film Next Stop Utopia. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to ask maybe a more general question in the beginning. Why are you doing films, and what does it mean for you? Why didn't you stay with architecture, as this is your original or like the where you were starting? And how did this experience of a French man living abroad influence you with your topics and thinking about film?
Many questions.
Sorry.
why I'm doing films? This is a question I asked to myself for many years. Sometimes I'm doing this job as a job, something like 30 years. 30 years, maybe a bit more, from 85. This is, yeah. And almost 40. For 20 years, I asked myself this question, what I'm doing films? And I was once in a big crisis, and I was alone on holidays in a small Greek island. And I met some people who we were camping in the area, and a small house which rented from some people, local people there. And I invite those people, because we had a nice contact, to stay at my place. And I was there for writing a script. And during this stay, or 3 days I stayed, I told them stories. And they were listening to me. They were a bit younger than me, and they were listening to the older elder man telling stories. And I suddenly realized that's the reason why I make films, to tell stories. Mm-hmm. And I realized some years after that you can tell stories, because I was doing or hoping to do fiction films, and it was not so easy, because I was from French origins. I was a French citizen, and Greece is a small country. There is not much money. It's not a cosmopolitan country like France or Britain or Germany, where you have a lot of artists from foreign countries living there. In Greece was not then like that. And it was difficult for me to get the budget, to get the financing to do fiction films. So because I had, not a very close contact or relation to documentary, but I had with reality. I was found, I was in love with reality. And even in my short fiction films, the reality had a good, a very important place, a part of it. And then I couldn't make fictions as I wanted, so I tried documentary. And I realized I fit very much. I love it. I love the real people. I love the real people telling their own words. They are their own characters. And then when every time I try to get back to fictions, said to myself, but the actors are not good, you know, because I was used to real people. And the dialogue are not good because the real lines people said is so incredible and so richer that I could write myself, maybe some very good writer or anyway better than me could write incredible lines. But the lines I heard from the real people was so great and so on. And that's why I stuck to documentary when I realized that I could tell story with documentary and story, the real stories. But of course, you have to tell the stories. And, you know, so why I am doing films? I think because I love to tell stories. I love the stories and I love people listen to me telling stories. You know, it's a kind, usually if you make a kind of job like that, you have an ego a bit too big. Hopefully with the difficulty of making films, especially in Greece, especially in a country where you're not born, your ego is a bit stretchy. Mm-hmm. And it's a good thing. And even in documentary, your ego is stretching a lot because you have to listen. Mm-hmm. And to watch, but mostly to listen. And so that's why I think because I'm doing films and I'm doing especially documentary, this is the reason why I stayed in Greece. Mm-hmm. You know, because I find my place here as a filmmaker. I think if I was going back to France, I didn't come to Greece for this reason, I've come for other reasons, but if I would go back to France, I will be just one between the other. In Greece, I'm something a bit different, because even if I've been living here for nearly 40 years now, which means more than the half of my life, and I'm not 80. And I have a way to watch and to listen reality. Maybe the other, my colleague here, which are more Greek than me, than because I were born here and raised here, I could find an interest to some things that the local people feel it's obvious. And I think it's exactly what's about documentary. Documentary for me, it's a way, a different way to see what we call reality. Mm-hmm. Reality, it's a concept. It's not, you know, does reality exist? Is your reality the same as mine? This has to be proved. And, you know, many philosopher and thinker and they think this thing very much and they don't agree between them. So it's a way to even to make philosophy, to make a documentary. It's your consciousness in front of the world, in front of what we believe it's a world. And a very special way to see it without to change it. You don't try, you know, I think I am, I wouldn't say a school of documentary, but you know, a tendency in the people who make documentaries, you are people and making films generally, or maybe art. Yeah, they are kind of people who want to express themselves and other who want to express the world. Mm-hmm. I believe I belong to the second part. I don't want to express myself. I want to express the world. And expressing the world, maybe I express myself. I don't want to prove anything. I don't want to prove, you know, I have my own ideas like every human, every citizen. But my goal is not to express my ideas or to convince the people of my ideas. My utopia, maybe, it's doing a film, doing a documentary, which means filming and telling a story. I insist on that. You tell a story, telling a story about and with the reality. You know, it reminds me of this slogan of Lincoln, you know, one of the first president of the United States, to say democracy, it's the government by the people, with the people, for the people, you know. And I think documentary, it's creating a story with the reality, for the reality. that's what I try to do. And that's right. I try to do in most of my films. And it was a long process. I'm not satisfied. But it's my character who will never be satisfied. You can't always get what you want, but you can sometimes get what you need. And when you work, you make films. I would like to make more films that I'm able to make. You progress and you find your way. Walking, you find your way. It's like when you make a documentary, you have, okay, a kind of script, a kind of goal, but the real one, you write it doing it when you make your film. And life, it's the same. You have a goal, but you learn things walking. If you stay, you don't learn anything and you don't progress. And had some goals which I still have very early in my career, but it was blur. And growing up as a person and as a creator, you learn a bit more about how to do and why to do and that's it. I don't know if it's answer a question.
No, you dived into many topics that I wanted to address. You dived into not comparing, but putting next to each other the documentary genre and the fiction, which is fine line, and there are many preconceptions about the documentary being the truth, and I think, or the reality, and I think nowadays is challenged even more and more, that there is a fine line between documentary and fiction, but also people reflecting on not having one reality, as you said, like our reality is different. We might meet, but we might not. And I think that this satisfaction or not satisfaction with ourselves is what keeps us going. That's the motto. As soon as we start sit still, then I think we are doomed. But when you you spoke about expressing the world, mm-hmm. and how was this world of As Far as the Sea coming together? I wonder, because you proposed us a world, we dive into it, and it has many different nuances. When I was thinking about one word about your world, I would say genuine, of genuine feeling of being with the people. So the question goes into, what was the genealogy of the film, and how did you develop it? When did it first hook you? And how did you, again, like complex question, you take from it what you what most talks to you, but how did you develop this language reflecting on the moment of the place where you were there? How was it coming together?
Yeah. Your question is complex, and I'm afraid my answer will be more complex. But anyway, it's simple in a way. It's simple. The genealogy of this film is very simple because it's something I've lived. I was myself a patient in this hospital for 2 months. And this was 30 years ago. Mm-hmm. And even a bit more than 30 years. It was 30 years ago when I made the film. I had an accident when assistant director. I was the first Greek assistant director of The Big Blue, you know, this Luc Besson film, which was part of it was shot in Greece, in a small island. And the day before the shooting started, I had the problem in my back and I couldn't move, you know, because I've carried many very heavy things and things like that. And I was sensitive with this part. And I stayed 1 week there, but the things I was stay 1 week light. I couldn't move because it was very, very painful. And so they decide to send me in Athens, you know, to see me in a hospital to see what they can do. And I left my job and I never met actually the actors because I left. I met Jean-Marc Barr, you know, 2 years ago. Mm-hmm. This was 35 years ago, you know, and I had a very nice contact with him, and we decided to make a film together because I had a project of fiction film which is. It fits very much to the character. Anyway, and I went to this hospital, and a friend of mine came to take me at the boat, you know, if there were not planes from this island. And she took me to many hospitals. Only one hospital accepted me. It was this hospital, CAT in Greece, which means it's a name of this hospital. It's a CAT with a K, not with a C. And I stayed 1.5 months there. And until they tell me, after 1 month, 1 month, they told me I had to make an operation. And I didn't want to make the operation because I see around me the condition were not good, you know, that there were people having the same thing I had, having made the operation, it was not successful. And it's a very common operation, but it's very delicate. You have to open, you know, your spine, and, okay. And, but I saw what I collect in this hospital. I was in a ward, in a room, supposed for six people, and we were nine, and there were all the families because they, you know, in the Greek hospitals, they don't have the enough means to support you, you know, like they could do in Germany or in France, like the nurse could do everything. So the mothers, the wives, the husbands. Have to make a part of the job, and result in this, I don't know, 15, 20 square meters, we were all the time not less than 20 people. You know? And this was an experience. It was an experience first about the hospital, but it was an experience for the human nature, you know, and they were all young people having an accident of a motorbike. They were from 16 to 22. I was then 30, I was the oldest, you know. And I don't know, it was such a great experience. So I learned so many things about myself, about the people, but the society that I had in mind since then to make a film, and I would have to call it Cat People, you know, joke, play on the words, cat with a K.
Yeah.
And until the middle of the shooting, the name was Cat People. You know? Mm-hmm. I first wanted to make, of course, all those people had a big problem with their bones. There were, you know, broken legs, arms, heads, you know. And then, because the medicines was different then, when you break a bone, you have to stay in a hospital for a long time. Not for an arm, but if your legs and if the break is not good, you have to, I don't know, they put an axis in your leg, and you have to have the weight to make it, you know, in tension. And so people could stay for 15 days, 3 weeks. And so in these 2-3 weeks, the ward, the room, the hospital room, became a small society. Mm-hmm. You get to learn, not only to learn people, to have friends, enemies, and things like that, but you have suddenly all the elements of a small society are creating. Mm-hmm. And you know, you have the leader. I was the leader of jokes, you know, because I was the older. I was the leader of jokes. I teach them how to make their temperature rise. You know, you make like this, and the thermometer can get to until 42. And so the nurse would come and so, oh, it's an epidemic here. Something is going on, and so we. So, you know, people, I learned about, so kind of small society, which was a kind of miniature of Greek society. Mm-hmm. With and even with the crew of the hospital, the doctors, the nurse, the clean woman, the, you know, you have the best and the worst part of Greece. The worst part was the lack of organization. The best part was full of humanity. Mm-hmm. You could have the a relationship with the clean woman who were coming every day and asking you about your health, helping you if you are, you know, this, you put a drop, you put, was not running well. And they were really caring about you, and it was so human. And human means not only good things. Human could be, you can have a doctor with a, not, you know, was really rough and, or, you know, so, I wanted to make this film like a miniature of Greek society. Mm-hmm. It would have been a portrait of society. Mm-hmm. And with this in mind, then I was not thinking yet about documentary as a fiction film. Actually, I wrote it as a fiction film for a kind of competition with Bavaria Films for young people, then young directors. I didn't win. and then I had this film in mind, and but I changed direction. I start to make documentaries, and the more I like documentaries, I didn't think anymore about making a fiction film. So I had the ideas and even scripts I wrote for fiction films, but it was always a documentary on the way. It was immediately, you know, because fiction films always a long time, you know, between before something is happening. Documentary is not so quick as I would like, but it's quicker. Mm-hmm. And so I made documentaries, and something like 10 years ago, it was, yes, 2009 at the for once a success with a film. It was a film about the Greek courts, about the justice. Mm-hmm. And this was in Cannes then in 2009. So when you have a success, you immediately make a proposal, and you immediately make the most difficult proposal you have in your drawer, you know. And mm-hmm. the most difficult for me was a documentary about this hospital, the concept was, it was a kind of concept film, actually. It was to be filmed only in one room of a hospital. Mm-hmm. And in this hospital, that's why the name was Cat People. And the camera should not go out of this maybe very little for the beginning and the end, but mostly don't go out this room and have this kind of, try to have to film this kind of small society with all the passions, all the families, the sellers, because you have even sellers who come to sell you things, and kind of lottery, or some monks who will send you cross or things for good luck and things like that. And actually in 2010 started the crisis in Greece. You might remember the Greek crisis. So little they would have kicked us out of Europe, of European Union. And the result was the crisis of financing films. It was very difficult to find financing. And the Greek Film Center, which was the Greek national broadcaster, is the only place you can find money to make a film in Greece. They didn't finance any more documentary for something like 5-6 years. Mm-hmm. And after 5-6 years, suddenly someone I knew very well called me from the Greek Film Center and told me, Marco, are you still interested to make this film? And I say, yes, but which film you are talking to me about? I forgot this proposal. I said, yes, okay. And I because he was taking all the proposals mm-hmm. of the last 6 years, and try to not to kick the one who didn't want to mm-hmm. to be realized, and keep on let those that the director would insist to submit. And so I was chosen. This was in 2015, something like that. And I said, okay, but I was finishing something. Then I was producing this Next Stop Utopia. This film was a occasion we met some 5 or 6 years ago. Yes. And I think it was in January 15. And I wait for 6 months to have the time to put an assistant to make a little of research. And I was waiting to be difficult, you know, to get the authorization from this hospital. We sent the mail and they answered immediately. Okay, you should see this doctor who is this director of a clinic, mm-hmm. orthopedic clinic. I wanted an orthopedic clinic. And they put me in the hands of the director of an orthopedic clinic. Wow, great. But it was not so great because this director have another idea. He didn't understand what is documentary, what is mm-hmm. to make documentary. He thinks, you know, documentary is those things, you kind of small reportage you see on TV. You know, some journalists go with a camera and ask 2, 3, 5 questions to someone. And in 1, 2 days, it's finished. You know? But when I told him that I want to stay 15 days, having in mind I will stay 3 months, you know, the things are started to get more complicated because, of course, maybe you know, but maybe people who are watching us now don't know, I make mostly films without interviews mm-hmm. and without comments. That means if you want the film to tell something, you have to shoot a long time to shoot. Mm-hmm. and have a huge material, and then you will edit this. Mm-hmm. So the process of shooting can take months, and the process of editing twice more months.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And so you never tell it, of course, to the people you are going to shoot because they will get crazy. But of course, you have to. They have to understand it's not a question of some hours or even some days. It's a mm-hmm. process which will take a long time. This was the first difficulty. The second difficulty was the reality had changed mm-hmm. completely. And the reality I was looking for didn't exist anymore. Mm-hmm. I mean, there were still people in the hospital. Now there were not nine, there were six. Okay. Mm-hmm. Better for them. But you couldn't find in a room of hospital, in a ward, you couldn't find six young people together from a bike, you know, from motorbike, like I wanted, because I wanted to be young people, you know, it's more alive, it's the community is getting quicker, the small society. It's even funny. I didn't want to make a film, you know, which would be very heavy. The film I made is a bit heavier than this one I want to make. And I thought about it like a kind of comedy, you know? A black comedy, but a kind of comedy. And, you know, that's why I wanted young people. And, but, you know, you could, because what had changed? The medicine has changed. Now, if you break your arm, your legs, they make an operation immediately, and they put you a piece of metal. They put you screws, you know. And 2 days after, you left the hospital, you're home. You go home. So it was only in some very rare case you stay there, and the case of older people who, you know, they who broke their hips and things like that. So the reality I wanted to find didn't exist. So I get in the process and I, you know, I change clinic, I change hospital, I go to everywhere, it was the same. So I would say I won't go for people having an accident, I won't go to other kind of disease, but it didn't work because, for example, the only disease I found a clinic that accept me in a big hospital in Athens for AIDS. But you know, I didn't want to make a film about AIDS because it's not something you will do. You know, if you have people in a clinic for AIDS, the issue of AIDS will be the more important in the film. This is not what I wanted to shoot and to show. And I went for a clinic for disease of blood. Mm. And the guy accepted. There, they stay a long time. You know, the kind of leukemia or how you call that? I don't know the word in English for EMA. Something anyway, and the director of the clinic was very helpful and said, yes, you can come to shoot, but it's only a small problem. What is the small problem? The problem is we have to don't let microbes come in your clinic, so we don't even let the family of the patient. I will leave you. We take measure with a mask and you know, things what we do now. But can you imagine I let you come in here as you want, and I don't let even the wife and the mother to come in there? It will be very difficult psychologically for the patients. Okay. And I was in, you know, after this takes almost one year, you know, we were going here and there and be disappointed. And so I thought I was two solutions, or I give back the money, I don't make the film, you know, which is crazy. You know that as a producer, you are struggling for the money, you have the money and suddenly you cannot make the film, you know, or you change film. And I try to change, you know, to adapt. Maybe I can set up the room, you know, choose the patient. And but even this was very, very difficult, because every patient in the big hospital, you have a lot of doctors, a lot of surgeons, and every patient is one surgeon. And the surgeons, they will not accept to be two surgeons in the same room, because everyone is a king. the surgeon, the king, he has his own passion. So it's a difficulty. And then, you know, it could be kind of possible, but suddenly I realize that I will change completely the reality. So where is your ethics about filming reality and not changing everything, which I teach, you know, because I'm a teacher of documentary. And I teach that, don't change the reality, you know, don't move anything. Don't say anyone what he has to do. And I will change everything, I will make a fiction film, okay? I would have made a fiction film with real people. You can do that. Some very good films were like that, you know? But I was not feeling well with this idea. And I went to holidays. And then another time in a desert island, and I was swimming when suddenly a non-writer, I met him there. I knew him. I said, "Oh, Marco, I'm pleased to tell you that ERT, the Greek television, national television, has accepted your project, this project. And they put some more money." And he told me, and I was in a committee, and I vote for it, because this reality, I know it. And when I was writing a script for a friend of mine, how you call that in English, in the rehabilitation center, it's this reality, rehabilitation center. I haven't thought about that. Mm-hmm. And so when I came back to Athens and I ran to the National Rehabilitation Center, and the guy was, the director was very helpful, but I explained to him and tell me, yes, I would like very much, it's a good idea, but unfortunately I don't have young people at the moment. Mm-hmm. And you know, I went to see the rooms, and they were mostly, you know, important, old people, and I said, my God, what will be dreadful if I make the movie. And he told me, why don't you go to Katz hospital? But I said, I was coming from there. And there was, you know, there, I didn't find in orthopedic clinic. No, in a rehabilitation center in Katz hospital. Mm-hmm. And I didn't know. I was, months and months trying to find a clinic in the hospital. And there was a rehabilitation center in front of me, I haven't seen it. And so I run again there, and I took, this kind, they tell you, you have to have a two-page proposal. I have my two-page proposal in hand. And I knocked the door of the rehabilitation center, and a guy opened to me. He didn't wear, the white, blues.
Doctor thing, yeah.
He was with the shirt and I asked, "Where is the doctor, the director of the clinic?" He said, "It's me. What do you want?" And I said, "I want to add my proposal. I want to make a film about the blah blah." And said, "What you have in hand is a proposal. It's a script." I said, "Yes. Can I read it?" And he read the log line and look at me. You know, log line is a sentence. In this sentence, it's a kind of very, very small synopsis of the film, you know, like you tell, like you have in a newspaper, you have the list of the film, and this film is, a guy trying to find his mother. Mm-hmm. He had this the few words. He read the words and looked at me and told me, "Where were you so many years?" And in 1 week, you know, I'd because this guy was he's in the film. He's a doctor we see in the beginning of the film. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, he's going. He's taking. He's getting retired. Mm-hmm. After a few minutes of the film, in reality, after two shootings. Mm-hmm. And but I didn't know when I met him. And he took me to see the patient hospital. Of course, it was different. of what I've thought. First of all, there were no room with 6 or 9 people. Most they had 4, but mostly 3. Three people. So the idea of this small filming a small community, very small room as a small society was not possible. This concept film I had was not possible anymore.
But and, when you, I will jump to it just with a question to this. You say concept film. Yeah. When I was watching the film, it was striking that it was not judgmental. And I think by sharing your story, and now I understand this was your personal experience. Mm-hmm. For me, it was so important and so unique that I did not at a single moment feel emotion of pity. Yeah. It was more empowering emotions. Like it was like eye to eye level. People had accident, but nowhere in the film I felt sorry. I felt I'm crossing fingers for them that this is going to work out, that they are kind of heroes. Of course, they are heroes of your film, but they are heroes of their life, that they are empowered. And I was wondering, from this moment when the doctor opened the door for you, till how long did it take that you were in such a relationship as a director with the patients, with the clients, that they would let you share, that they would share with you this vulnerable moment in pride? Because I felt like this had to be a really long journey. How long did it take?
This was very quick. This is interesting. Mm-hmm. This is interesting. Because if the maturation of the film took 30 years, you mm-hmm. know, in fact, the real film I made, it took 1 month to, you know. I think I met this doctor, if I remember, end of October or beginning of November. Mm-hmm. And he told me this, I was going to tell you when you interrupt me, and you did well, because I don't know to make short movie. And he told me, I see everything was possible now, even in the... But it's not the film I wanted to make, exactly. It's something else. Anyway, okay, let's adapt to reality. This I learned with doing documentary and getting a bit more mature, you know, because in the old days, you know, I was like looking for gold, you know, and if I meet diamond, a mine of diamonds on the way, I would say, no, I don't want diamonds, I want gold. I've learned to take, and at the end, you have not the diamonds, neither the gold. I learned to take diamond, you know. And this was real diamond. It was another film. I saw immediately was another film. First of all, the reality of the disease will be much more important, because you can't have in the first plan the. You know, once you have people tetraplegic who cannot walk, who cannot take things, you cannot just have see the society of the room. You have to deal with the real issue they have. And so, okay, I accept that. But the director of the clinic told me, okay, it's everything okay. You open me all the door, even to the meetings of the doctors, which is, the door should be closed, because it's a secret of the, you know, the medicine, the mm-hmm. secret of the doctor. It's like to the, even the psychotherapy, mm-hmm. they let me inside. You know, it's like to go in the priest when they make the confession. Mm-hmm. You know, I was not even thinking of daring asking them, mm-hmm. but they proposed to me. You know, mm-hmm. the opposite of what's going is happening usually. Usually, you ask for something and they resist before they give it to you. It was the opposite. The only thing this doctor told me, okay, when are you thinking to shoot the film? I say we are now in beginning of November. Let's say in spring. I said it's okay. So I will introduce you to my successor because I will going to get retired on 31st December. I said, what? I knew with another daughter I will never succeed that. So I had to, and we start to shoot on 15th of December. So during that time, this 1.5 months, I have to get to know the patients, the doctors, to, you know, and all the, not all the people were so positive. Mm-hmm. And had to convince some of the patients to accept to be filmed. Mm-hmm. And the doctor was a big help for that. If you see the film, you will see that he has an incredible contact with the patients. Mm-hmm. And this helps. They trust him. They saw this doctor trust me, so they trust me. Mm-hmm. Only one was thinking a bit more, the hero of the film, Gregory, which is more, you know, the family more, they're intellectuals, they're speaking together. When they make a decision, they speak, you know, in a great consciousness of that. So they had the kind of family council to decide if they will accept, if they will, the son will be, will accept to be shot. And they accepted. Mm-hmm. They only decided at the end that I will not shoot anymore. They won't let me shoot in their house when he came back to the house and this. And, but okay, after it's a, they understood first of all that I knew that. They understood that I didn't want to show them to feel pity. I didn't show pity for them. You know? I passed through the, I was, when I, 30 years ago, when I was in the hospital, I was, you know, it was a danger. I was, how you say the, I don't find the word in English, but I could stay paralyzed of one leg, you know, if I didn't make the operation or if the operation didn't go well. And at conscience of this threat, this word I was using, at conscience as the threat of paralysis. Mm-hmm. And so this changed something in my mind, and at this immediately to accept it. I thought it, and everyone think, I think, if you are in this kind of situation, my God, will be a tragedy. And when they told me that, it was not a tragedy. It was the opposite. It was very practical. Okay, now I live in a place on the third floor without a lift. So I have to move. Because how I can go with the, you know, the wheelchair? Mm-hmm. You know? Things practical like that. And so I was, of course, I've never been in their situation exactly, but in a, like, you know, what you make a vaccine, you put a very small dose of the microbes, add this very small dose and makes me think a little about that. And they understood that I wanted this, I wanted to make a film from the point of view of the patient, not from the point of view of the doctors, or the point of view of the journalist, or the point of view of the director. I wanted to make a film from the point of view to make this was my aim from the beginning, from 30 years ago. I want to take the viewer in the bed in the hospital room. Because for me, it was a big experience. For myself, mm-hmm. I've lived that in myself. You know, I've been many times before to be hospitalized. I've been many times in a hospital to see a friend, to see a member of my family. And it was very heavy, sometimes tragic, you know. But when you are in the bed, it's very different. And I've been, since then, had the, you know, I made an operation in heart, I make things, you know. And I, every time, the same feeling. It's not, you don't see, okay, it's sad. You don't want to be there. But when you are there, you have to be there. Okay, mm-hmm. you are there. And for the time you are there, you accept this condition. Otherwise, it's impossible to live that.
Hmm.
I am very practical to that. And I wanted to feel that to the viewer could experience a bit that. I don't know if I succeed that because only in reality you can succeed. But a bit of that maybe understand. That's why there are no pity. There are no. That's why. Because I feel the same.
Yet I have a question to this. You wanted and you succeeded, in my opinion, to take the viewer to the shoes or to the bed of the person who is undergoing this procedure. Yet you, as a documentary filmmaker, of course, you had this personal experience that I didn't know about, which explains a lot of things that I was questioning. How come you reached this point and how long this development took? But now I understand it took very long and personal. You were in those positions, but still, you as a documentary filmmaker, as a filmmaker, you knew more than the people by the fact that they allowed you to be part of those meetings with the doctors. I was wondering, like, that there is sometimes this position of it's cruel position of documentary filmmaker or filmmaker who knows more than the patient, and you have to keep cynical. In a way, or is, I don't know if it's cynicism, maybe it's not the proper word, but maybe you knew more about the discussions, how they were talking about chance of this or that patient that they will walk or not, or how their condition can develop, and you wouldn't be able to share, or were you able to share? You know, like there has to still be some kind of distance that you kept, although you were very close. So this is very tricky balance to keep. I feel.
Yeah, that's a very good question or remark, because you know, we share with those moments you have of hope. For example, we have a character who is moving a little his toes, you know, and he's so happy. He's so happy with something. So it's a beginning, you know. If I move this, after I move that, then I will walk, you know, because it's mm-hmm. a, you know. And we went to the, and we filmed that, and we have this in the film. We mm-hmm. go in a meeting of a doctor, it said, this doesn't mean nothing. Wow. And after, you have to go again mm-hmm. to the guy, and pretending you don't know.
Mm-hmm.
You know, this was heavy. Mm-hmm. This was heavy. And because, and they knew, the patient knew, we were filming the doctor, and they were asking us, what did they say? And we have to keep the secret. You know? This was difficult. And this is, okay, you are right to underline that. To be in the shoes of the other, it's an utopia. Yeah. You never, when you are, you know. Just you can, because you have been in their shoes, and in all my documentary, I'm a little, when I make, I choose something because I've been a little in the shoes.
Mm-hmm.
I made a film about the justice and the trials because I've been to trials as an actor, you know, a real actor in this. Mm-hmm. I made a lot of film about immigrants, you know, because I'm a kind of immigrant.
Mm-hmm.
Again, I'm not an economical immigrant. I'm not a refugee, of course. But I can understand a bit what is to move from your country to, and mostly if you can't come, cannot come back to it. What is to go to a new country? You don't know the language. You don't know the people. You have to make your, you know. And so I made also documentary about immigrants, Greek people told me, but you don't speak about racism, you know, because all the people, I'm happy to tell you, but maybe it's my ego. I'm one of the first who make films about immigrants in Greece, you know, and I made because they were talking about racism, not only racism, but it's not only, it's an issue, of course, but it's not the main issue. It's not the one issue. You know, there are so many issues in this theme of migration, the immigrant. And it's the same here in the hospital, you know. But I know a bit, I know much more than them about them. And I have to accept I'm a director, you know, I'm a director making a film. And I accept it. I don't have this utopia that you would, but I want to try, you share this. And this sharing, this place you have, the situation as a director, you know one point of view and you know the other. You can give it in the film the way I try to give it in this film, that we are mostly with the heroes, with our character, but we are also with the one, with the doctor. We can get in the room of the doctor and have this counterpoint, you know, and have this, you know, very often in documentary, in this, I try to teach my students about that. You have the characters and you have the commenter, comments. You have those to act, who make the action of the film, and you have those who comment this action. And this is a very strong thing in a film when you change point of view and you have the comments. It's not a comment of a director saying, it's a comment of the some people who worked even in the film. And I think this and gives the interest for me of the film. Because you are not only, you know, an active waiting for your, you know, you see this and this creates the conflict.
Όλα θα γίνουν, ρε, don't worry. Υπομονή του Ιώβδη. Τα πάτη του πίσω θα τραβήξω, αλλά όλα καλά θα πάω.
Θέλω να το πάρουμε μπροστά και τέλος υψηλά. Για τους εργόνατα.
Δηλαδή, ο ορθοστάτης δεν τον βοηθήσει. Εγώ σου είχα πει και την προηγούμενη φορά ότι τους ανθρώπους που πιστεύω στον εαυτό μου, πιστεύω και σε κάποιους άλλους και σε άλλα πράγματα, εντάξει, και στον Θεό πιστεύω και στην οικογένειά μου και αντλώ δύναμη από αυτό το κομμάτι, οπότε δεν μπορεί να με κρατήσει τίποτα, σε ξαναπεί αυτό. Εντάξει, εγώ ήρθα και να φύγω όρθιος.
Το να πάω πνήσω τις πολυκατοικίες στο αυτοκίνητο, χρειάζομαι ένα μαξίδιο 1,000 ευρώ.
Εντάξει, δεν έχεις καταλάβει τη λογική, οπότε δεν έχουμε.
Πέντε μου τη λογική. Θέλουμε να είσαι τελείως αυτόνομος.
Εγώ δεν θέλω να είμαι αυτόνομος. Λέω από τη μάνα μου, πατέρα μου. Δεν εξαρτάμε.
Άρα μας κοροϊδεύεις. Τι φοβάσαι, μην τρακάρεις.
Είσαι σίγουρος ότι θα τρακάρω.
Το να έχω εγώ την ελπίδα, όχι την ελπίδα το 0,1% να περπατήσω, πάντα υπάρχει, το ξέρω, εντάξει. Αλλά κάποιες φορές νιώθω ότι... ένιωθα ότι με βλέπανε ως καταθλιπτικό που εγώ προετοιμάζομαι για κάτι το οποίο δεν θα περιλαμβάνει χέρια, δάχτυλα, πόδια και κοιλιακούς.
Thank you. So That leads me to another question about question that was already probably answered partly, is that the when one plans a documentary, when you are having a story in your mind, there is always a moment of surprise, and so like kind of moment that makes you think, aha, I will have to do it differently, my film, than planned. Moment when you turn around partly. So I was wondering if this moment was there for you, and how much were you thinking about the audience when making the film? The moment when the audience leaves the cinema, what would be the emotion or the thought that you would like them to leave with?
Mm-hmm. Luca, the change, the switching points in making a documentary, it's always, this always happened. This always happened. And it's the interest for me of making documentary. Mm-hmm. I don't know if I would be able to make fiction now, because I will miss that. You know, it's maybe not a thing to tell to you in Azerbaijan, because you have the experience of war very close, which I never had, fortunately. But I comparing doing a documentary like doing war, you know, when you are, or to be a general of the army, you know, you are going to the battle, you have to have a schedule for this battle. You do have to know, of course, you mostly know who is your enemy, but you suppose the force of your enemy will be organized in a certain way, and you organize your force, your forces, in your own way to surprise them, and you go on the battle, and it's not like you have thought it, even if you are the best general. Or it's like this at the beginning of the battle, because you surprise them, but after they, you know, they counterattacked, and so you have to adapt. If you have a plan, you know, like a script, you will lose all your, you know, you have to have this script, but you have to know you would be able to change it. Mm-hmm. And if you are not able to change it, you lose the war. So when you are documentary film director, you sure have, you know, thoughts of the things, how you will make. But all the time, the reality is not the same. You know, you have been hundreds of times in the same place to see how the things are doing, where are the people, what they're saying. And you go one time more with the camera, everything has changed. Mm-hmm. So you have to adapt yourself. But what you have done, you don't throw it to the garbage, you know, because the essence of it will stay. This is the important, the essence. To know the essence of your film. But even for the essence of the film, I had to, when I see that the reality I wanted to shoot was not there anymore, and suddenly they offer me a reality which is might be much more interesting of the one I was thinking. Maybe, I don't know, the film, the other will never make it. And you have to adapt everything. Mm-hmm. And even the essence of the film changed, because it's not a film which I would say the hospital world as microcosmos, as a micrography of the big reality of the Greek society. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not more that. It's a film about accept or hope when you have, you know, an accident of big, could be an accident, this could be the death of someone you love, it's good, you know, this is about this. If suddenly, as an accident, your life will change completely in one, in what second? You come from this and this change and you cannot go back. You know? What would you do? You know, it's the essence of the film. So of course, it's an hospital. Concretely, it's with some people. So, and so this, you know, if you are used to change, you will do it. You know? If you are not used, you know, the first, maybe some decades ago, it will have much be more painful. Maybe I will refuse to change. I've done it. I lost occasions. You can't imagine how many occasions are because I was this, no, I want this, like a child. I want this, no, I want this toy. No, okay. But I could see that here there is an interest. They offer me the key to open this room, you know, a room nobody can go in. Nobody can go and see the doctor talking together about the patients. And they said many things very personal. You know, there is also with the people who were injured like that, who was tetraplegic, there is a sexual dimension, sexual issues, you know. When you are, you have a disease, not a disease, but...
paralyzation?
Yeah. When you are hurt, you know, at the neck, and the spin is cut, you know, I don't know in English so well.
Spine. Yeah.
You know, the spine means your brain cannot command anymore your body from here until down. That means you cannot control to go to the toilet, to make sex or whatever. It's not only to move, and you know, and so you have some issues, very personal.
Yeah.
And they let you enter that, and they risk the doctors. If you are, you know, they risk because someone can sue them. Why did you leave this guy? If they trust you for something because you can damage them. And you are open, so there is no problem. You will go there, but you have you feel the interest. You know, and I feel it more, of course, because I was through this process in a smaller scale, of course. But I was through this process, so immediately I see there is a film there, and you have to now to go this film. You have to write it. You know, without without to rehearse, without, because you are in a hurry, because you have those people, even that you have those people. You know, it's not like you are a producer. You know that. You know, you have your first shot, you make a trailer. You know, you have your character. No, here this character, they will stay in the hospital for some few months. If you don't shoot them. After, there will be other characters. You don't know if they will be interesting. You don't know if they will let you shoot. The doctor will have left. Who doctor will support you? You know, when he left, this doctor, it was much difficult after. We were about to be kicked out of the hospital. You know? So you have to do it now. It's like in a war. You have to, you know, it's not the enemy is here. You can say, okay, wait, I'm not ready. You know, you have to fight. So, so I did it. So, and then you learn through it. What does that mean? You know, but you are so much contrasted. It. You have adrenaline and you see, and you risk. Maybe you fail. You don't know if you. So the other, I don't know if you understand.
Absolutely.
This question. The other question was how much I think about the audience. You know, the first audience is me, but which I'm not the best audience because I've lived that, and my partners. Because obviously you don't make a film alone, and that's a good thing. When I went with my director of photography, which was also my cameraman, my sound engineer and my assistant, that was the crew, I understand their reaction. You know, for me to see this, the hospital, the people injured, I see worst thing in the hospital I was, in the rooms I were. And so, not I was not moved, I was moved, but I could stand, you know, they think. My partners, I see the way they had a shock at the beginning, but they got used to the things. And so this helps me to understand the way could the, you know, of course, after there will be the editing, you can insist or can show or don't show. You can insist or not. Can go long time or stay little time. But the first impression is that the first viewers are those. And I think everything, I had the impression if you have the, if you look in a, and I knew that my in my cameraman, the cameraman is very important because, you know, it's a prolongation of me, you know. We have to watch in the same way, otherwise the film is not possible. And it's not the kind of film you can, any film I do that you, you know, you put the camera here and, you know, the camera tell you, okay, I put the camera here, come to see. It switches to you the frame, and no, you don't have time. He has to shoot. You have to let him shoot. You know, you just say, "Hey, no, look there." It's the only thing, but you have to trust him. And so if you remember this this scene in the elevator, you know, there is one of the most beautiful scene in the film for me. You have those two characters who once they had, he has a problem. They are both in a wheeling chair. And once had a problem, it says, they don't know each other, really, they don't know each other. They get to know, they will become friends and kind of comparse in a film, you know, they will, comment and they will be against the doctor and then get to know in front of us. But we followed one and the other came the last moment in the elevator. And he came, there were two with the wheelchair. There were two with a wheelchair. So not many people could be in the lift. So I have to leave the lift to let my cameraman and my sound engineer, in fact, they are more important than the director, because without them, there is no film. The director could be maybe no film, but there will be a scene. And I let them in the elevator. It was on the fifth floor. And I ran to the ground floor to wait for them. And they came out, and my cameraman said to me, "Great, you know." So I knew this thing will be great. And when I saw it, and you know, we didn't. It's one shot in real time, and it's so well. The timing of the scene is so good. You don't think you have said it, you know, like a fiction film. The door, you know, they stop at some stairs, the door open and close, you know, and they, after they said it, the balance between the dialogue, it's perfect. So you have some moment all the time in films where it's a kind of magic. It's a, like Maradona said, it's a hand of God, you know. So God put his hand in this moment. And in films, it's real, in a documentary, it happens all the time. So there are those moments, I'm sure, of the reaction of the audience, you know, and I'm sure, leaving that It's not a film when you will leave, you will forget it immediately. You know, because you have passed through things and you have become so, a reality would could be shocking, you know, to see young people like that would be shocking. But because they have humor, they have, you know, it's life. You don't film only the difficulties they have. You film the moment, and we have a character who is actually is the most injured. And it's the most tragic. He's the most tragic. It's the most, he has the most humor of all of. It's only with him you laugh, you know. And yeah. He's tragic. It's a young guy, 22 years old, a beautiful, successful. He has a girlfriend. He's the first of the class. He's a student. He has a parents are perfect and everything. And suddenly, when he dives in the sea, things which he does in the same place for 20 years, and he instead to go like this, he go bit too much like that, you know. Instead, hits not the rock, the sand, you know, and he breaks his neck, and he will be paralyzed for his life, you know, and he would say, and this guy has humor, and you laugh with him, you know, and he is in the mind of the first film I wanted to make, you
know? Yeah.
It's a bad comedy.
Yeah, I have to say that for me, it was, you speak about the difficulties and it is there, of course, but throughout the film, it was celebration of life, actually. Yeah.
Yes, but that's it. It's exactly, this film is celebration of life. Even there is life. Maybe you asked me, I answer now your first question with something more, much more interesting that I like to tell story. It's my way to learn. Making documentary, it's my way to learn. I learn enter words I would never enter. I learn things I would never learn. If I have nothing to learn in a film, I don't make it. You know, if I have something, okay, I go, I tell you, I make film for things I'd a bit experience of it, but doesn't mean I know everything. Means I have this small experience, I want to know more. And there I learned a lot. I hope the audience a bit.
Thank you. This was perfect words for the closing. I encourage everybody to watch the film if you haven't yet. As Far as the Sea by Marco Gastin. Join us at DokuBaku. Join us through Doc Alliance, our partner. And thank you for watching. Bye.